Episode 11. Hello, thanks for tuning in to this special Wednesday night episode of Dogman Encounters Radio. I'm Vic Condiff, and I'll be your host as we listen to eyewitness encounters involving one of the most terrifying cryptids, Dogmen. Our guests tonight are Donna Fink and Dianne Beeson. Donna is a Dogman researcher who's based out of Milton, Wisconsin. Dianne is an author who has a fictional Dogman book that's going to be hitting the presses soon. Donna and Dianne, welcome to Dogman Encounters Radio. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Please, both of you, give us a brief bio on yourselves.
This is Donna, and I became interested in the Dogman from reading Linda Godfrey's books about the Beast of Bray Road, which is only about a half an hour down the road from my house. And I didn't realize that there were things like that out there that existed. And then in her books also, I started reading about that there were sightings close by my home of Bigfoot by Lima Marsh, which is very close to my home. So when my kids were grown, I found somebody who was interested too, and we just started going out in the field and looking for Bigfoot and the Dogman. And it's been a real interesting adventure since then.
Dianne, how about your bio?
This is Dianne, and I live in Cincinnati, so I'm in a very urban area, and I first came across the whole idea of Dogman on a podcast interview I heard with Linda Godfrey. Anyway, I heard an interview with her probably 6 or 7 years ago, and it absolutely blew my mind. And so I went over to my sister's house, and I said, I got to write a book about this, you know, just sort of a fiction, because it was so bizarre and so chilling to me. And I said, you want to go to Wisconsin? And she goes, sure. So we took off, and we came up to Wisconsin for a long weekend and just checked it out and had a great time. And it's been sort of one might call it a Dogman love affair in a very bizarre way ever since.
How did the two of you meet?
We actually met at Creature Weekend last year. Donna was there with a friend of hers. I was there with my sister and my niece, and my niece wanted a T-shirt like the one Donna had that had her logo for her Southern Wisconsin Wild Ones Facebook group. And so anyway, we got in contact with Donna then and just started talking, and we haven't shut up since.
we're kindred souls. We found that we probably go way back. Yeah.
I can tell you two get along really well together, so that's good.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's too bad we don't live closer.
That is a shame. Cincinnati and where you live, Donna, in Wisconsin, that is a pretty good drive, unfortunately.
Yeah. It's too bad.
What kind of experience in the woods did each of you have before you started researching Dogman?
For me, it was really almost none, other than just regular, standard growing up stuff, camping and that kind of stuff. I am not a big outdoors woman. I'm the first one to admit that. So I have very little experience in the woods. I don't know what's out there.
But she's so well read and so well versed in all the paranormal aspects that it's just a great, great match. And they're coming up this weekend and we're going out to the Bigfoot Dogman area. So
yeah,
we'll have to keep you posted on what goes on this weekend.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'd love to know. Last weekend, you two spent some time around in and around Salt Fork and in Coshocton County. How did that go for you?
We had fun.
Yeah, you know, and it was what's interesting. I have to tell you, this is kind of an interesting, and really this is about Bigfoot. But when we were there last year, last fall was the first time we rented this particular cabin. Donna, unfortunately, wasn't with us that time. But we had noticed that this was a very remote cabin. It's on 42 isolated acres, you know, out in just farm country. And it's very near a place called Woodbury Wildlife Area, which has been known to have a lot of, you know, Bigfoot activity and so forth. anyway, when we were up at this cabin that weekend, we had noticed all weekend long, all the dogs in the surrounding farms were very, very vocal all weekend. A lot of just nonstop barking going on. And I didn't know. I just figured these dogs always just barked all the time. What do I know? But then one night, we were all sitting out on the deck and we heard the strangest, I'm going to call it a call. It wasn't really a howl, but it was the strangest call we had ever heard. And the dog that was barking before this started had shut up. This call went on. It was a long, high-pitched, like a mournful sound, a call ongoing for 30 seconds at least. It just pierced the night air. And we all just froze in our seats and were completely blown away. And as soon as this call stopped, all the dogs just lit up. They just went ballistic all around. Now, I don't know what that call was from, but we've heard something very similar on various recordings of purported Bigfoot calls and vocalizations. So I'm thinking it might be something like that. I've since been to that cabin two other times and have not heard the call. And not only that, all the farm dogs in the area have been very, very quiet. And I just kind of put it together this weekend, and I'm thinking maybe that's why those dogs were so agitated all weekend, was because something was in the area, whereas the last two times we were here, it was very, very quiet and nothing happened. Just an interesting little observation, that's all.
Hearing a creepy call like that, that would get your attention. Dianne, the first time that you heard the term Dogman, did you scoff at it and say, that just couldn't be? Someone's just got a big imagination. Or did you remain open to the possibility that Dogman just might be a reality?
I was open to it, to tell you the truth. And I think it's because of all of Linda's research. I mean, the first time I even heard it was Linda Godfrey doing this interview on this podcast. And I believe at that time she had just come out with her second book, which was Hunting the American Werewolf, I think, if I have them in order right. And she was going over all the research that she had done and listening to all of that. It seemed while really bizarre, it seemed plausible to me. So I thought the term Dogman was kind of bizarre, but I'm open to a lot of things. Let's put it this way. I don't just shut my mind off to things when I hear something a little different. I'll go ahead and look into it. So that's kind of where I'm from.
Well, that's a good thing that you're open-minded like that. Donna, how about you? The first time you heard the term Dogman, did you scoff or take it seriously?
Well, I always look at it as there's so many people seeing things and they describe them, and they're normal. They seem to be normal, credible eyewitnesses, and I don't understand how people can say, you didn't see that, or I don't believe in it, when it's been seen by so many. Or even Bigfoot, anything, the Loch Ness Monster, any kind of paranormal thing, if it's been seen by a lot of people and they're credible eyewitnesses. The Dogman was seen here in Wisconsin by a young lady who took a lie detector test and appeared on Monster Quest. And she saw three Dogmen drinking out of a stream using their cupped hands. And then they rose up and started walking towards the kids. And of course they all got into their cars and took off, but then she even passed her lie detector test. So I just, you get credible people talking about unbelievable things, and something has to be going on. That's the way I look at it.
Katie Zahn is who you're talking about there in Wisconsin. Yes. They had those encounters.
Yes.
Speaking of Katie, yes, I need to talk to her, see if I could maybe interest her in coming on for a show.
I have contacted her a couple of times because she's a Facebook friend, and she lives right here in Melton in my same town. And I've tried to get her to do an interview with me just so I could put it on YouTube or something so people could hear more about her experience, because of course on Monster Quest they kind of briefly go over what she saw and everything, but I would like to go into more detail about her sighting and everything. And she told me on Facebook that she really wasn't afraid. She was never afraid of the dogmen. So if they didn't instill any fear in her when she saw them. And that's about all I've gotten from her so far. So I wish you luck. I hope so, because I'd love to hear from her.
I know you two haven't spent too much time out in the field together, but I do know you've spent at least some time out there. What outing researching dogmen wound up scaring the two of you the most?
Go ahead, Diane.
I'll go ahead and kind of tell my one and only, I'm going to stutter all over myself here. There were two times that I went out, okay, and the most recent was when we came out there last year and visited you, Donna, and you took us out into the woods and some just strange things happened, but it wasn't particularly frightening per se. I have to say I haven't really been scared in the woods in my research because I haven't seen one. But
no,
I have gone out and looked for them. Our initial trip up there was pretty interesting. And if you'd like, Vic, I can tell you about that.
Sure. Love to hear.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, this was what my sister Jill and I, you know, when I decided that I was going to, you know, write a story about the whole Dogman thing, we took a trip up to Wisconsin, and it was in June, and it was beautiful weather, and we just hit the road and headed up there, you know, with Linda's books in hand and, you know, as much information as we could gather, which, aside from Linda's books, was about all we could find. And we got up there with the goal of spending a lot of time in the Kettle Moraine forest up there. We had some experiences, just really more observations than anything else while we were there that we thought were pretty strange. And the first thing that happened, we stopped at the edge of the park at this little cafe store, kind of like a little quickie mart, to buy some cappuccinos. And when we were at the checkout, the cash register, the cashier was run by a woman clearly of Native American ethnicity. And we asked her if there were any bears in the area, because we knew we'd be spending some time tromping around in the woods and didn't know if we had to think about bears. And she just kind of started laughing and said, no, she goes, there aren't any bears out there. She said, bears are not the problem. And she just started, like, chuckling to herself. And I was surprised by this and didn't ask her further, and I kicked myself to this day for not asking her further. But as we went ahead and paid for our coffee, she stood there just chuckling to herself and laughing and shaking her head and saying, not bears, not bears. You know, so that led us to believe she knew something which we were, you know, not with it enough at the moment to ask her about.
Uh-oh.
And yeah, so that was just kind of the first thing that happened when we were there. And then we went to the visitor center in the park, and they've got a very nice visitor center there, and we were walking around in there looking at all this stuff, and I was going to go to the restroom, which was out through the double doors, you know, and out on the other side of the building. And as I was leaving through the airlock, I almost ran right into a forest ranger who was coming in the door. And he was a very nice young fellow, and he was all smiles and happy and everything, and I decided then I wasn't going to make the same mistake as I made with the cashier at the Quickie Mart, so I asked him, I said, hey, what do you make of these werewolf things out here? And the smile dropped from his face, and he leaned in and looked at me and said, are you camping here? Have you seen or heard something? And that took me aback, and again, I dropped the ball on that, and I just kind of said, oh, no, I just read about it in a book. And then his demeanor changed again, and he started laughing. He goes, oh, all that. He goes, wait, what are you talking about again? And I said, you know those wolves that supposedly walk on their back legs? And he goes, oh, no. We don't have that down here. I think further north, maybe further north. He goes, well, I don't really know. He goes, hey, ask one of the night rangers because we don't ever see that stuff during the day. And boy, he bolted out of there so quick. And
strange.
I thought this was really strange.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Wow.
Yeah. I wasn't expecting that kind of reaction, that shift from happy to serious to then, you know, backpedaling and blowing off, you know? I mean, it was really strange. So that was pretty interesting. So then we decided that while we were out, because we knew that they were often seen with roadkill on the side of the road. Obviously, they have a scavenger role to some degree. And so we thought, well, we had a map, and we thought, okay, we're going to drive all around the area, and we're going to mark on the map all the places where we see dead animals on the side of the road, and then we were going to come back at night and check all these places out and kind of just cruise the area, hoping to see something eating on the roadkill.
I said, to see if you could catch one eating.
Exactly, yes. Because that's how a lot of people see them. We drove around that entire county for 4 days, Victor, and we did not see any roadkill anywhere. There was one little tiny dead black thing, like maybe a baby raccoon or something. That was all we saw in 4 days. And this was on expressways, county roads, park roads, residential streets, highways, everything. I mean, it was completely clean, completely void of all roadkill. I've never seen anything like it. And I thought this was really strange. And so, you know, we asked a couple of people that we kind of ran into randomly here and there remarking upon it, and they said, oh, Wisconsin's just a really clean state. No, okay, all right, that's fine. Well, you know, we'll go ahead and buy that. But what was really interesting is when we left Wisconsin to go home, we came straight south into Illinois, and we were still very keen on the whole roadkill thing, and we're on the expressway, and we had driven maybe a half an hour into Illinois, still not seeing any roadkill, when all of a sudden, just like that, all of a sudden, here they are, you know, dead dog, dead bird, dead raccoon, dead deer, dead, you know, all, you know, peppered all over. You know how it is. Like it is here in Ohio, there's roadkill everywhere. And when we got home, I was looking in Linda's book for the range of sighting reports that people make for the Dogman, and it was all around, you know, that area of Wisconsin, of course, and it went down about 30 miles into the northern part of Illinois. I thought that was interesting. And it's not that I think necessarily that Dogman just picks all the roadways clean. I think that we wondered, I guess I should say, if maybe the counties or whatever just keep it clean just to reduce maybe sightings. I don't know. It was just a thought I had, but I found it really interesting. So if Wisconsin is really a clean state, then how come that top part of Illinois is also very, very clean? And it just happens to coincide with the range of Dogman sightings, at least at that time. I don't know if that's changed over the years, but that's the way it was then.
I can tell you, living in Wisconsin, there's roadkill everywhere over here, all over the state. So if it's clean there, there's a reason for it somehow.
Right. I mean, there has to be. And it was just very, very strange to me. You wouldn't normally pay any attention to that either unless you were specifically looking for it. Another thing that was very interesting, too, and this was about specifically Kettle Moraine, there are no garbage receptacles anywhere in the park, even at, you know, like trailheads and stuff, even in the bathrooms. There were no trash cans anywhere for you to throw out your picnic or anything. Another thing that we had also noticed was that their dogmen are often seen, you know, rummaging through people's garbage cans, too. And that was another part we wanted to kind of note where all the trash cans were and go through and check those out, too. But there weren't any of those either, except in the camping areas where there were dumpsters that were fenced in, or enclosed, I should say, behind three walls 8 feet high of concrete, the cinder block. with the front big heavy gates and heavy chains chaining those things shut. And there aren't supposed to even be any bears, and even if there are bears, there's very few. I can't imagine that they did all of this to block an occasional random bear that may happen to wander through the area. I could see that in places where you've got a heavy bear population. But why are they protecting these dumpsters so much in these camping areas? I thought that was weird, too.
The walls that they had over around the dumpsters, was there any kind of a ceiling to keep something from climbing that wall and getting over?
I did not notice that, no. I don't think so. The walls were just very high. Like I said, they were like 8 feet high. So I suppose if something was very adept at climbing, it could have gotten over that way, but it really would have had to make quite a jump.
Dogmen are supposed to be quite the jumpers, so if all they had was an 8-foot wall, that shouldn't pose pretty much any kind of a barrier to them.
Oh.
But who's to say the people that constructed those walls didn't know any better, so... As far as the whole roadkill topic goes, Dianne, that's very interesting, but with as widespread as dogmen are, like you mentioned towards the end of that point, I think it's a matter of the municipalities cleaning up the roadkill rather than having such high populations of dogmen that you wind up with clean roads because, like I said, they're so widespread. If it was actually dogmen that were responsible for that, then I think the clean roads would be a lot more widespread than what you're seeing.
Right, and that's what we thought too, that it wasn't necessarily the dogman picking them clean, it was the municipalities cleaning it all up, and we were just making guesses. This is all just guesswork, but it's simply observations that are interesting.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, yeah. And there was one other thing too that was interesting about our visit there to Kettle Moraine, and on two separate nights, Jill and I went out at night, very late at night, after it was dark, and just went and sat, like there was one time we went to it was a trailhead, and it had some picnic tables there, and a restroom, and a parking lot, and it was just a trailhead, so there's nothing else there, and it was closed, nobody else was there, it was dark, and we just went and sat back to back on the top of a picnic table, armed with flashlights, and decided, well, you know, by God, we're just going to sit here for real quiet for like a couple hours or whatever, and every now and then randomly turn on a flashlight and shine it into the woods to see if anything's coming out. I don't know. Looking back on that, that was probably pretty stupid. We did it. We did it because we just wanted to see something so bad. Well, nothing happened. But what was interesting is this is in the summer in the woods in Wisconsin. And this was the quietest woods I've ever sat in. There was no sounds of the night, no tree frogs, not even crickets. I mean, no night birds, nothing. It was the quietest, and we were there for several hours, and we heard no sounds whatsoever. I thought that was weird, too. Again, we didn't see anything, but it's just... These are just observations that we made when we were up there that was different than any place else we'd ever been. So I thought it was interesting.
Well, that's not a good sign that the forest was that quiet. That's a pretty good sign that there might have been something there watching you. Yikes.
Yeah. Yeah, and that happened on two different nights in two different places, too. So I don't know. I just, you know, any time I've ever been to any forest, they're noisy places at night.
Oh, sure.
So,
yeah, like a concert almost. Donna, do you take anything special out into the field with you when you go?
I take my camera and my cell phone, of course, in case something grabs me and I can call somebody. And I take pepper spray and a knife to protect myself more from humans or cougars rather than Bigfoot or the Dogman. Because I've been in those areas so much and nothing has ever harmed me and I know that there's things in the woods and I'm not really afraid of, I mean, I haven't seen a dog man, so maybe I'll be afraid when I see one, but nothing's ever harmed me when I've been in the woods. I just worry more about humans, really.
That comment that you just made poses a question. If you were to encounter a dogman out in the woods, do you have a plan in place for how to
how to run faster.
Yeah, or how to trip Dianne, maybe.
You just have to be the one that runs faster. The girl I used to research with was 6 foot tall, and she was 15 years younger, and she did take off on me once, and I grabbed her before she could get away, and I told her, if you leave me here alone, there's no way I'm going alone. So,
what happened?
Well, that was when we were in our Bigfoot woods where we went looking for Bigfoot because I'd heard there'd been a couple of sightings in the area. I read about one in the newspaper. I went back into the archives and I read that there were a couple out by Lima Marsh, which is only about 9 miles from me. And I'd always been interested in Bigfoot, so we went looking for Bigfoot, and what happened was it seemed like a portal opened and all kinds of weirdness came out. Not only do we think that we've had Bigfoot there because we've cast prints that were 17 and a half inch long, and then come spring there were 14 inch prints, 11 inch prints, and then by July of that year there were 9 inch prints. And we've cast them all, I videotaped them, there's trails of prints. I don't find as many prints anymore. I think they wised up to us and they said, oh, maybe we should stop walking out in the middle of cornfield. So I don't find as many prints anymore, but what happened was in looking for Bigfoot, I think we ran into an area where the Dogman is also. I'm not sure what else out there. We went into the woods one day, crossed over, went around a mud puddle sort of, it didn't have a lot of water in it, but went into the woods, there were no prints in the puddle when we went in. But then when we came out of the woods, there were 2 wolf prints in the mud that weren't there when we went in. And then later that night at 2 o'clock in the morning, Linda Godfrey reported to me the next day that at 2 o'clock in the morning, a girl that went to her church called her and reported seeing an oversized wolf with glowing blue eyes sitting on the corner by our Bigfoot woods. And that's when things started getting weird. Then we started finding 5.5-inch wolf prints all around, even in the middle of the Bigfoot prints, all near the Bigfoot prints. I don't know why. I thought, you know, if they were buddies and they were hanging out together, I didn't know what was going on. And we cast a bunch of those prints and trails of wolf prints. It seemed that there was only one wolf, so I'm not sure. And then one time and this is bizarre, but, you know, I would take a lie detector test. It happened. If you believe me, you believe me. If you don't, you don't. But we were going out to our research area a week later, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, sunny afternoon, going to our research area, heading out, and we were driving east, and in the westbound, on the westbound shoulder was a young man walking, and his hair was shocking because it was completely matted, like he had been living under leaves under a bridge for a couple of years, but his clothes were clean, which was weird. And he had on a zip-up hoodie, but underneath it was a red plaid flannel shirt, and blue jeans and blue Keds. I'll never forget it. And he was shocking to look at his hair, but then when he looked up, we both screamed at the same time. And it was because he had a pronounced brow, not huge, but bigger than normal. But what was really shocking, he had dark circles around his eyes, and his nose to his lip was a bigger space than a normal human. And it kind of looked like a gorilla or a chimpanzee mouth that protruded. So it was a protruding mouth, but not as much as a muzzle. And big, flat teeth that were twice the size of ours. You could see almost all the top teeth and all the bottom teeth. And Jackie said she saw fangs. I didn't because I was driving. And I was going 60 miles an hour, so I'm not sure. But his teeth were streaked with green and brown and yellow. They were awful. And we both screamed at the same time. So we thought, we're not letting this pass. We're making a U-turn. We're coming back. But to tell you the truth, I didn't want to pull over next to him because at this point I'm thinking skinwalker, shapeshifter, I don't know what it was. And because it wasn't a normal human. And I went past him. We pulled in by the cemetery. We turned around so that we could get video and pictures because we knew he was going to come walking by us, you know, in the next couple of minutes because he was headed that way. And all of a sudden, a white van came driving east like we were, made a U-turn. The white van was completely unmarked, brand new, had like a raised roof on it so like you could stand up inside the van. And a man was driving it. I don't know if there were two men in there or just one, but it pulled up next to him, and Jackie was yelling, "They're going to pick him up. They're going to pick him up." And I said, "No, they're not. Who would pick him up?" And suddenly the cargo van doors are opened. The guy got out, opened the cargo door vans. I don't know whether the weird boy got in. That's what we called him. Either he got in or he was put in. I don't know, but then the door shut. They made another U-turn, and we pulled out right behind them, and they disappeared. I was doing 70 miles an hour trying to catch up to them, pulling out probably 10 seconds after they did. And we went 70 miles an hour looking down both sides, all the driveways, all the side roads. Never could find that van again because we wanted to catch up to them and see what was going on. And that van just completely disappeared. So I don't know what that was. And then shortly after that, a couple of months later, my husband and I were coming home. It was about 7 in the evening, about 2 miles from my house, coming into town. And we think a deer is coming across the road, and then we realize it's not a deer. We had to completely stop the car to let a wolf saunter, trot across the road in front of us. It looked like a brown timber wolf. And then go across the side of the road and then just go on into the field. It didn't look at me. It just kind of glanced around and just trotted across the road, big as you please. And I thought, I don't think that's a coincidence, but I don't know. And then one time we were in the woods and we knew something was in there with us. And as we left the woods to go, we had to cut across about a block and a half of cornfield to get back to the truck. And it was getting dusk. We were in there later than we should have been, than we planned to be, but we were kind of disoriented in there. Even though we'd been in there a lot and we knew the area, we were having a hard time finding our way out of there for some reason. But we finally found our way out. We were 10 feet out of the woods, and we heard one wolf howl, very loud, with kind of a laugh at the end of it. And we just took off running for the truck. And I told Jackie, I said, you know, we had 1 week flashlight between us because we weren't going to be out after dark. And I said, shine that flashlight behind me, you know, because she's running faster than I am. And she goes, why? And I said, because I want to know if there's a dog man coming. And she said, what difference does it make? And I said, because I'll run faster. And we just kept running. There was nothing coming. It didn't chase us. I think it was just messing with us. I think it was in there the whole time. It was 2 square blocks of woods in this area, and I think it was in there the entire time and was just messing with us, like just trying to scare us or goofing around or whatever. It didn't try to hurt us. We were in there walking around, and it was in there somewhere.
You've had some strange activity going on around you.
Like a mini Skinwalker Ranch, if you ask me.
Yeah, it sure sounds like it. Really strange activity. Now, I know about all the videos you have on YouTube, Donna. The
yes.
One that jumps out at me the most as being the most interesting is the one where you're interviewing Travis about his encounter.
Yes.
Could you share with the listeners what happened to Travis?
I heard about Travis and his sighting through friends, and he was willing to go out to Stores Lake with us where he had his sighting. He was with, in 2010, he was with four guys. They were looking for the Dogman. They had heard about it on television or the radio, some program, and, you know, it was around Halloween, and so they were talking up the Beaster Bray Road and everything. So those guys thought they'd go out because Travis lives here in Moulton with me, you know, in the same area. And Stores Lake is about 2 miles from our house, so they went out there, drug around a piece of bloody venison. There's two lakes and a pond there. All of a sudden, something came crashing up from the pond, up the steep hill towards them, and they at first thought it was a deer. And then as it ran past them, they thought it was a bear, don't have bears here, but there might be an occasional one. I don't know. The DNR will tell you there are no bears here. And then he noticed, they noticed that it had, the back legs were like dog legs. And they ran like heck to their car, and they started to drive away because they were so scared. And because they knew this was something really unusual. And they all calmed down. And Travis said, this is why we came here. We came here to see a Dogman. We need to go back and see if we can find it. So they came back down the path, down the road. It's paved. And they were shining the flashlight around. And all of a sudden, on the right-hand side of the road, in the brush, almost into the woods, but not quite, in the chest-deep brush, was about a 5 or 6 foot Dogman. He said that it had yellow eyes. They didn't glow, he said, but when they shined the flashlight in its eyes, it didn't cover up its eyes or anything, but it was standing there on two legs. And he said it had pointed ears that stood up. It had a muzzle. And you don't know, you know, young people, are they telling you a story? Are they just making it up? Are they embellishing? Just some things that he said, and I've talked to him several times. His story has not changed one iota. And some of the things he said, you wouldn't know unless you've done a lot of research. Like, they wouldn't say that it came up on four legs unless you know a lot about the Dogman and Bigfoot stories. I would think you would say, yeah, it growled at us or it chased us or something. He didn't say any of that. He said that it didn't make any move towards them. It didn't make a sound. It just stood there. Of course, at that point, then they ran back to the car and took off and never went back. And he hadn't been back to that site. They were too afraid to go back until we went back during the daytime. Went back to in the daytime, took his statement, and then went down to the pond to investigate. Even though it was like 2 years later, there were prints all around the pond, at least on the sites we were on, and there were, it looked like Bigfoot prints, but it also looked like some weird, long, narrow prints, like with toes, kind of like a dog, but then longer and narrower, almost like a dog would, if it was walking on two legs, would almost put down part of its back leg in order to steady itself. I'm not sure. I can't swear that it's a Dogman. I don't know. But there were odd prints. And then I followed some structures up through there. I've been in there a lot. I found deer legs hanging from trees, partial spines of animals in the trees. I found a deer leg the other day. It could be anything. I don't know. I don't know what could put a deer leg up in a tree. It wasn't hunting season. It was a fresh leg. You could still see the blood. But then I thought I heard rock clacking behind me. So I'm not sure what's going on in there. Obviously something is, because we smelled something terrible that wafted through the area when we were looking at the prints a couple of times. So it came from up on the hill in the woods and just wafted down through there like twice, and we all smelled at it and commented on, oh my God, what is that smell? And then it just went away. So I'm not sure that there's Dogman and Bigfoot in there. You know, according to his report, and he drew a picture of it, it looks like a Dogman.
I watched that video, and he seemed genuine. I think he saw what he claims that he did see.
I believe so, too, because I was really careful to... I talked to him like at least three times, you know, once before we interviewed him, and then two or three times after. And the funny thing is that about a year after that, he was staying... Well, probably 5 miles down the road near Lima Marsh where his grandmother lives. And he was up in the upstairs bedroom sleeping, and all of a sudden he heard a big howl outside his window, some kind of either Bigfoot or Dogman noise. And what he was most concerned about was that he was praying that his dog did not come out of its doghouse and was listening for the chain on the dog to make sure that the dog did not come out and be harmed. He was that afraid. And I believe him there again, because he was more concerned about the dog than he was about telling me any kind of story. He didn't see what was out there. He couldn't find anything. He didn't want to wake his grandpa up because he knew that he had to go to work the next morning. and it seemed to go away, and the dog never came out of its doghouse. It was a German Shepherd, and it didn't come out of its doghouse.
Thank goodness it didn't come out of the house.
Yes, yeah. So I believe him because he seems sincere about worrying more about the dog than anything.
Yeah, he seems credible. Dianne, what kind of homework did you have to do in preparation for writing your book? You're writing a book, from what I understand, that hasn't been edited yet, but I believe it will be soon, and consequently it will be out on bookshelves before too long, correct?
I certainly hope so. It's finished. It's edited and everything. Well, not... We're still trying to get an agent for it, and I didn't write it by myself. I did want to say this, I did have the help from my sister Jill as a creative consultant. She's got some great ideas and really helped me sort of flesh the story out, and basically it just came, my research was pretty much just reading articles online and reading Linda's books and trying to find anything on podcasts. Oh, I wish your podcast was out back then, Vic, because I've been listening to it, ever since we first contacted you, and it's fantastic. I really love the stories that the people tell. So it was really just a lot of reading mostly, Linda's work and a few other, random articles here and there about it, but I get the impression that the whole concept of the Dogman has really gained in, I guess I'll call it popularity, or maybe I should say just recognition. Over recent years, more and more people are talking about it now than they used to. Yeah, so it was just reading, going up there, checking things out, talking to people, stuff like that.
I know the answer to this question before I ask it, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Let me guess. You two would give almost anything to have been into Dogman the way you are now, back when the whole Beast of the Bray Road buzz hit, back when Linda Godfrey got into this.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Definitely.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
Yeah, especially with Donna living right there.
I know.
I didn't even know until I was watching the Discovery Channel or something, and then I saw Linda Godfrey on there on some program, and she was talking about the Dogman, and I said, a Dogman? Oh, that's just so scary. And then Monster Quest came on, and I loved that program, and I was hooked. I mean, my kids were younger then, and, I really couldn't dedicate any time to it, but, as soon as I could get out there and get the nerve to go locate and have somebody to go with, that's when I started doing some research.
When we went up there and looked around, we talked to a lot of people, and it was amazing how many people had never even heard of it.
That's surprising.
And they were right there where it was all going down, supposedly, according to, all Linda's research, kind of put that whole Kettle Moraine area sort of as Dogman Central, at least at that time, that we knew. I mean, and then after a while, I started to hear about, they called the Michigan Dogman and reports up there, and it's only been in the last few years that I start realizing, oh my God, they're everywhere. I had no idea. It blows my mind.
Yeah, you wouldn't believe how many people contact me with no concept of how widespread these things are. There are so many people out there that are convinced that Dogmen are only seen in and around the Great Lakes area. But yeah, they're seen in Maine. Shelley Rockwell Martin had her encounter in Maine. That's a lady that the episode of Paranormal Witness was done about, titled Wolfpack. Mm-hmm. You've got encounters happening in Canada, over on the West Coast, in Oregon, Washington State, California. These things are just all over the place, down in Florida. Yeah, it's not a regional occurrence. Pretty much anywhere you go where there is a fairly large body of woods.
And they always seem scarier than a Bigfoot. When people encounter them, they get more of a feeling of evil than you do with a Bigfoot, for the most part. And that's what makes them so scary, too.
Oh, yeah. To back up a little bit here, Dianne, What made you decide to write a fictional book about dog men instead of a nonfiction book about them?
Well, I figured, first of all, that Linda Godfrey had all the nonfiction covered, you know, I have this imagination, you know, where I envision all these weird things, and I had never thought of writing about something like a dog man until I heard her stories and her interviews, and the more I looked into it, it's just so weird to me that I thought it would be fun to take this thing as a character and just weave a story around it. And it was a lot of fun to do, a lot of hard work, but yeah. So it was a good time, and it was I didn't make the dog man into a purely horror character.
But there were a lot of chills in that book.
A lot of chills in the book, but it doesn't read like a bad B movie, you know what I mean? Where like I saw that movie, The Beast of Bray Road. Did you ever see that, Donna? It was so awful.
No, I heard it was bad.
Yeah, I saw it, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's not like that. It's not like that. It doesn't go wreak havoc on all a bunch of teenagers in the woods or anything like that. So, yeah, but it's fun. It's a fun book and just kind of an adventure with a, you know, group of people and, you know, a mystery too. So, yeah, I think it turned out well. I just hope we can get it published here soon. I don't want to go the self-published route if I can avoid it. So we're trying for agents at this point.
Have you settled upon a name for that book?
Dire Consequences.
Oh, okay. I'll have to make a mental note of that because when it's out, okay. I'll definitely want to get my hands on a copy.
Oh, sure.
After,
okay.
Like the dire wolf?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's clever. I like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, yeah. It was fun. Fun little read.
Oh, I'm sure it will be. I'm looking forward to it. I know that the two of you don't get together all that often, but when you do get together, I know that you've been in some areas that were supposedly very heavy with dogman activity. Do either of you get to the point sometimes where you stop and say to yourselves, what in the world am I doing out here?
Absolutely. Right, Dianne?
Yeah, I would say Donna probably does more than I do because I haven't been out with her very often. Just Wisconsin's far away. Although this weekend I may be saying that, Vic, because we are going up there this weekend. We'll be tromping around in her woods very soon. So I'm hoping for something bizarre to happen. Not scary, but not terrifying, you know? So
right.
That right balance. Creep me out, but don't make me have a heart attack, you know.
Yeah, that wouldn't be good, that's for sure. You've said things that lead me to believe that you probably don't think that dogmen are all that dangerous, but when you hear about encounters where they do things that seem so aggressive and so scary, it can't help but make you start to wonder, at least at sometimes, if you are really leaving yourself out there by going out into the woods unarmed or without being in a group of people, how dangerous exactly do the two of you think dogmen really are?
I think they're a lot more dangerous than I originally believed. And I have to wonder if some of that is just regional behaviors. Like the ones up in Wisconsin, as far as I know, nobody's ever gotten injured by one up there. But yet, when you read reports from people other parts of the country, they seem pretty hostile. So, yeah, I think I'm a little more afraid of the whole concept of the dogman now than I was a few years ago. Yes, that's my two cents.
All I know is that I try not to read too much about the dogman before I go out by myself. Because if I did read about the scariness of it all, I probably wouldn't go. So every time I read something really scary, like missing 411 or a scary part of a dogman story, that one Dogman story where the house was surrounded by dogmen, surrounded the family. Wasn't that in Maine?
Yeah. Elmira, Maine? That's right. That happened to Shelley Rockwell Martin.
Yes. And when I watched that program and heard that story, well, then I don't want to go out for a while. But and on the other hand, I don't go out at night by myself. I go during the daytime, and I'm on private property, unless I'm at Stores Lake, and then I try to stay in the main areas. But when I'm on private property, nothing has ever hurt me, and I know there's been stuff in there. I know there's been, I don't know if it's Bigfoot and Dogman. I don't know what's going on, but I know there's plenty of things in there, but they've never hurt me, and I don't get the feeling that they want to hurt me. I don't get bad vibes in there. So, and that, when we heard the wolf call, it could have chased us. It could have appeared. It seemed more like it was messing with us. When we saw Weird Boy, that's what we call him. When we saw Weird Boy, I got the feeling in my mind that he was saying, I know you and you know me. And it was kind of tried to scare us, tried to just make contact, fooling with us. I don't know.
There's a video, Donna, that is on YouTube that you have made, where you're investigating some what appears to be dogman tracks in mud around this reservoir or a pond. You were looking at those prints moving along slowly when all of a sudden in the video you stated that you smelled this horrible scent just come over you all of a sudden. Tell us about, give us some background on that. What happened there, and just fill us in on that.
Well, that was the time that we had gone with Travis. We did the interview, and then we went down by the pond, then, and it's very steep going down to the pond. So whatever ran up that hill and ran fast had to be really strong, because we had to hold on to trees just to get down there without sliding all the way into the pond. But at the time, the pond had receded some, and now it's full, so you can't find tracks around the pond because it goes right up to the grass. But at the time, we hadn't had a lot of rain, and so he took us down there. But it was a couple of years after he'd seen the Dogman, and we still found tracks around the pond. And they had toes, and then there were some that were just completely unknown that I still don't know what they were. And no known animals. We know what other tracks look like and everything. And with the wolf prints and stuff we found, we measured the dog's feet in the area, so we knew they were 2.5 inches, and they're big dogs. 2.5 inches at the most was the diameter of their feet. The wolf prints we were finding were 5.5 inches. So, big wolf, I don't know, but when we were down by the pond and and then it goes up the hill into the woods, and the smell came up from the woods down to the pond, and it just wafted through. And I commented, I think, and then Jackie and Travis commented on the same thing. So they were a ways ahead of me, and they smelled it too. But then it's weird how the smell just goes through and it's gone. And it wasn't skunk. It was just a foul, it wasn't the pond, because the pond didn't smell before that. It just was a smell that just came through and it was gone. And then a few feet further down, it came through again. What I believe is that something was up there watching us, looking at footprints, looking at their footprints down by the pond. So I don't know whether it was a dogman, because you don't normally associate the smell with the dogman. Normally that's what people mostly think that Bigfoot does. And I think it's just something that they do like a skunk does. They just emit an odor at will, like a skunk. I don't think they just always smell. But that's just my opinion. So that's what was going on in those videos, because I think something was watching us looking at their footprints.
When you saw those wolf prints in the mud, did you notice a left-right-left pattern or a left-left-right-right pattern to them?
Well, I've seen different things. Down by the pond that day, it was hard to tell what was what, because there were so many prints. Seemed like there were Bigfoot prints mixed in with other prints that seemed to be different longer, much longer, well, not much longer, but much more narrow. And I cast a few of those too. And to me, they appear to be what a dogman, I think, would leave, where it puts down its foot, but also puts down some of that back leg in order to steady itself. But you couldn't really tell, you know, some of them went up to the water and it was just a left, right, like on two legs. I'm not a four-legged creature. But out by the Bigfoot woods, sometimes you'd see where it looked like it was walking on two legs, and sometimes you'd see where it looked like it was walking on all four. So I don't know what's going on. But when we came out of the woods and there were no prints in there when we, in that muddy area when we went in, and when we came out, there were two prints in a 12-foot diameter wet area. I don't know how you leave two wolf prints in a 12-foot diameter unless you're walking on two legs. You'd have to leave four prints.
Oh, sure.
Because they don't just jump in there on two legs and then jump out. You know, it had to be something walking on two legs.
Oh, sure. Yeah, it would have to be. If anyone listening is wondering what we're talking about here, when I pose the question about the left, right, left, or left, left, right, and so on, a bipedal creature like a dogman would have that left, right, left pattern. A wolf, for example, has a left, left, right, right pattern when it walks. That's what we're getting at here.
At our area, we saw whole trails, like we filmed and measured and cast. You know, we'd see whole trails of a wolf on four legs. But then we'd also find two prints where it appeared to be on 2 feet on occasion. One occasion was where it looked like it might have been chasing a deer, and it was on two legs. And we cast that print. But I think the deer got away because we didn't see any sort of scuffle or anything. So hopefully, I don't know, or maybe it picked it up and made off with it. I don't really know. But it appeared to be something wolf walking on two legs after a deer. And it only appeared ever to be one wolf out there, not a pack. And definitely not coyotes because the prints are way too big. Definitely not the dogs.
I'd say not with prints that big. To hit back on the topic when we were talking about the scent that you smelled, there are a lot of people that think that only Bigfoot emits that foul smell, but there is no shortage of eyewitnesses, dogman eyewitnesses, that reported that same type or similar type of stench when they saw their dogman, a smell that smelled like a mix of urine, sewage, rotting meat, smells like that. So just because you're out in the field and you smell some type of a stench like that, don't necessarily assume that it's a Bigfoot that is in the area. It just might be a dogman.
And see, I didn't know that. I'd never heard that.
So I didn't know that either.
Thanks for the information. I was just out there the other day, maybe last week at Storrs Lake where Travis had his sighting, and I was walking along the path, and all of a sudden I smelled that stench in one area on the path. And I looked around to see if there was, no, it wasn't skunk. I know that for sure. It wasn't anything like that. It was more like garbage or dead rotting meat or something. And it was just on one area of the path, and I looked all around looking for something dead, and I checked the woods in a 50-foot square area to see if I could see anything hiding in there, because the smell was so clear that something either just passed through there or was hiding there somewhere and had emitted the odor. So I smelled it again the other day, so, and I find big structures in those woods too. So I don't know if dogmen built structures. I've never heard of that. Have you?
I've heard people propose that idea. If dogmen do build structures, it would be the type threes. I don't put it out of the realm of possibility. It's very possible since they do seem to have fingers very similar to a Bigfoot's, so who knows?
Yeah, and I don't know, but I found plenty of structures in there, so I'm not sure what's going on in those woods. A lot of people say that Bigfoot has his territory and the Dogman has his territory. and they don't cross. I don't believe that. You know, I don't know why they wouldn't cross. I mean, of course they're territorial maybe, but from all that I've seen and heard, I think they're in there together. I don't know. Or one is hunting the other, like you were talking about on your first show. The guy thought that the dogman was maybe hunting a juvenile Bigfoot. I'm not sure. I don't know what's going on.
I've had more than a couple people pose that question to me about finding dogman prints right next to Bigfoot prints or dogman prints right on top of Bigfoot prints. And they were asking me about the possibility of them walking together. And exactly what you just said about the whole predation thing, that's my opinion about what's going on. I think that dogman was following a juvenile Sasquatch. It was hunting. That's my opinion. Why people see these prints next to each other or one on top of the other. Dianne, are you pro-kill or no-kill?
I wouldn't kill anything unless it was trying to kill me first. So I don't want them shooting Dogman or Bigfoot or anything, if at all possible, to not do that. You know, even if it would bring it into quote-unquote proof, you know, scientific proof, I just don't think it's, live and let live. I'm one of those types.
That's a good approach.
But of course, you know, but of course if he's coming after me and I happen to have a gun, I'm sorry, he's going down. But only as a last resort.
Oh, I don't think anyone could blame you on that. It
no.
comes as a surprise to people that aren't associated with Bigfoot research, or I guess to a lesser degree, dogman research, how many researchers there are that are out there that couldn't care less if Bigfoot or dogmen are one day officially proven to exist. Do either of you care if dogmen are proven one day officially to exist?
Not really. I mean, it would be nice, okay? I suppose it would be nice, but I don't know that it might do more harm than good to the species. You know, because if they're proven to exist, then everybody and their brother's going to be going out there trying to hunt them down and so forth, and I don't think that's going to help them. I don't need scientific acceptance to validate my own personal opinion of something, so I guess that's where I stand on it.
How about you, Donna?
I don't know that they're of this realm, so I don't know that anyone could ever prove that they exist, and I don't
right.
need anyone to prove that it exists. To me, it's a hobby, and it's fun, and it's scary, and I'm enjoying myself, and I don't care if somebody believes me. I don't care if they're ever proven to exist. Because I know what I've been through, I know what I've seen, and there's much more out there than anybody ever realizes or can even imagine. So to me, it doesn't matter. I'd probably be just as happy if nobody ever proved that they were real, especially if it means killing one or capturing one.
To wrap this show up, ladies, Dianne, first, do you have any closing points you'd like to share with the audience?
I don't have any closing points per se, but I do have a question for you, Vic. Something you said earlier when you talked about the type 3
uh-huh.
types of dogman, and you said something about the government calls it that.
That's right. The history on the whole type 3 name falls back to a gentleman that was mentioned on an episode of Bigfoot Hotspot Radio. The guys over on Bigfoot Hotspot Radio referred to a gentleman as Agent Black, I believe. This Agent Black supposedly is an inside connection they have, the way I understand it. He's an inside connection they have who works with the government. And he supposedly told, the way I understand it again, he told Wes and Will, the hosts of the show, certain supposed inside information about Sasquatch and also about dogmen. And Wes and Will say that Agent Black shared with them the fact that the government supposedly refers to the type of dogman that looks like a kind of like a giant baboon of sorts without a tail. Mm-hmm. Supposedly Agent Black has said that the government calls that type of dogman type threes. Now, I have yet to hear any mention of this Agent Black even mentioning canine type dogmen. I don't know what kind of vetting Will or Wes did with this gentleman to find out if this gentleman truly is who he claims to be. If he does have any true connections to the government, I don't know that. But that was the genesis of that name, Type 3 Dogman. The fact,
that's fascinating.
Yeah, it's interesting stuff. I wonder about the validity of this guy, because if he was so in the know, how could he not know about canine types? There are quite a few people out there that have seen Type 3 Dogmen that are totally opposed to the possibility that there might even be canine type dogmen. But most eyewitnesses that reach out to me are reporting encounters with canine type dogmen instead of type 3 dogmen. I'd say 65 to 70% or more of the eyewitnesses that I speak with about their dogmen encounters, they're telling me about canine type dogmen that have that canine type back leg with a backwards knee look and the more pronounced muzzle. They're not seeing, they're not telling me that they saw a more hominid type dogman with legs like we have or like Bigfoot's got. And if that's the case, why isn't that being mentioned by this Agent Black? I don't know. I wasn't on the inside of this. I never have spoken to the gentleman. I don't know what the situation on that is. All I can do is share with you what I believe I've heard them say about what he has said on their shows. That's the story on that.
That's interesting. I've never heard that. I really like that, though, because it is curious. And what's interesting to me is how people could say, I think there is this type, but not this type. You know?
Oh, sure.
You know, like, okay, there is a Bigfoot, but there could no way be a dogman. Well, why not? You know,
oh, sure.
If you can accept one, why can you not at least open your mind to the possibility of the other? So if there can be the baboon type, the type three, why not this canine type?
Oh, I agree. So, it doesn't make sense. Why be so close-minded about one thing when you're amazingly open-minded about another? I've heard some very heated debates on the whole canine-type dogman versus type 3 dogman subject. It's hard to understand, but there are two separate camps that are viciously opposed, it seems, to believing in the other group's type of dogman even existing. I just can't
That's
fathom
crazy
that.
To me.
No
that,
doubt.
That just seems so crazy.
I agree.
Arguing about things that nobody even really knows that much about. Nobody knows. And all the experts that are out there, supposedly, anyway, all arguing together. And it's like, I just think that just about anything's possible. I mean, I know when somebody's talking crazy, but, you know, that's different. But, you know, when you have eyewitnesses that seem perfectly to be perfectly normal people and they're telling you they saw something, you need to listen.
Well, I agree.
Right.
Just like you can check the validity of someone's story by comparing it against what most other people that are talking about that subject report, I do the same thing to check the validity of a lot of the eyewitness encounters that are shared with me. When I have so many people sharing the exact same physical features on the canine type dogman, they're sitting there telling me that they saw. When you've got that many people that don't know each other, that don't communicate with each other, giving me the exact same story, there's something to that. These people are seeing something. I'm convinced that there are canine type dogmen out there, and to brush that off as being nonsense, I just can't understand that.
I think, you know, if you really think about all the strange, just the high strangeness that's going on out there between all these weird cryptids, the fact that these are not just random single events and experiences that people have, but they can actually be classified into certain groups with multiple people that total strangers to one another, and even in different parts of the country or even the world, having similar experiences that all fit into certain categories. You have to really keep an open mind about this stuff, because I wouldn't be surprised if in some way they're all connected. We just don't know what it is. I think there's just a different realm to this reality that we don't even perceive fully, and somehow all this stuff kind of pops through. I don't really know. I can't explain it, but I just think there's so much more to it than just only UFOs or only Bigfoot or only whatever it is, Dogman, what have you. So my two cents, that's all.
You could very easily be right on that. I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank both of you so much for your time and being so nice as to come on the show and share all this good information. Thanks so much.
Oh, thank you, Vic. It's been a real pleasure.
Oh, likewise.
It's been fun.
Been a great time.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, please, don't be strangers, okay?
Okay.
That sounds good. I appreciate it. Well, both of you, please have a great night.
Thanks, you too, Vic. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.